Hola, muy buenas tardes a todos. Bienvenidos al webinar de la Red Latinoamericana de Fisicoquímica Teórica. Vamos a empezar en un momento, pero antes de eso, por favor, mantengan su micrófono y su cámara apagados durante toda la presentación y al final tendremos 15 minutos accesibles para preguntas. Ahora le doy paso al profesor Álvaro Muñoz de la Universidad Autónoma de Chile, quien presentará a nuestro ponente de hoy.
Muchas gracias, Jessica. Junto con saludar a todos los asistentes, para mí es un placer introducir al doctor Hugo Flores, que nos va a dar una presentación bastante interesante con respecto al modelamiento de varios materiales en función de algunos usos posteriores. El profesor Hugo Flores es investigador nacional nivel 1 desde SNI1. Él tiene una licenciatura en ingeniería física, siguiendo una maestría en ciencias físicas, el UNAM, y prosiguiendo un doctorado en ciencias físicas también en el UNAM bajo la dirección de Gerardo García Naumis. Tiene dos postdoctorados y actualmente reside como profesor asociado de la Universidad de Guadalajara en el Departamento de Ciencias Exactas y Naturales. CU Valle. Ha tenido varias publicaciones científicas, tiene un buen número de citas y también ha dirigido una tesis de especialidad y una tesis de licenciatura y actualmente tiene un grupo de investigación en la Universidad de Guadalajara. Entonces, para mí de nuevo un placer introducir a Hugo Flores, así que te cedo el micrófono y muchas gracias por aceptar la invitación y apoyarnos a nosotros como Red de la Latinoamericana de Fisicoquímica Teórica.
Muchísimas gracias por la invitación. Bueno, ahorita me queda una dudita de si debo de hablar en inglés o en español.
La mayoría del público está en español, es español, así que como te sientas más cómodo, si quieres la dan en español o en inglés.
Ok, bueno, pues si la mayoría del auditorio está en español, pues igual. No sé si hay alguien de otro idioma, pero bueno, a ver, vamos a compartir la presentación. Yo creo que ya se ve y le voy a
Perfecto.
dar presentación. ¿Ok?
Perfecto.
Muy bien. Sí se ve, ¿verdad? ¿Me escuchan claramente? Sí,
Está
¿verdad?
funcionando todo bien, Hugo.
Ok,
Y
excelente.
adelante.
Well, the title of my talk today is Computational Modeling from Hydrocarbons Unit Liquid to Phase Change Materials. So, first, I would like to thank to the organizer for inviting me today to this seminar. Also, I would like to thank to Andrés Cisneros because of his support and invitation directly. So as our friend told us before, I am a researcher in the University of Guadalajara in the Centro Universitario de los Valles, right? So first, I would like to talk something about the location. Well, first I would like to take a pointer. I'm going to change the color, maybe green. So here is Mexico, the whole country. Jalisco State is around here, maybe one of the most important touristic destinations is Puerto Vallarta here, close to the Pacific Ocean. And Guadalajara cities is here in general. We have several important zones or towns like Zapopan, Tlaquepaque, Tonalá, etc. So, but my office is here, right? So I have to travel from Guadalajara City to the office, Centro Universitario de los Valles. So I have to travel around 2 hours in the morning and 2 hours in the afternoon, every day. Well, now with the pandemic, I am working at home, but usually I have to travel, no? In the morning and in the afternoon. Well, so as I say in the title of the seminar, my talk is about two topics. One of them is the hydrocarbons and ionic liquids. Usually, well, in my case, I am working with computers, supercomputers, and we are interested in the modelation of some certain types of hydrocarbons like gasoline. And also we are interested in some ionic liquids in order to reduce the concentration of benzene, for instance, from this kind of systems. And the other part of the talk is about phase change materials. And here I would like to talk some results about our research. In general, phase change materials are materials that are in the crystal phase, then by means of a heating process, we have the liquid state, and by means of a cooling rate, we have the amorphous phase, and then we heat again this amorphous phase in order to have a liquid state also, and after a cooling rate again, well, a slowly cooling rate, we have the crystalline phase again, right? So as I tell you before, I am working, kind of system, I am working by means of the molecular dynamics simulation here, classical point of view, and these kind of problems by means of ab initio molecular dynamics simulation, right? So this is why I put this figure, right? Okay. So first of all, I would like to talk about the main problem about hydrocarbons and ionic liquids. So in general, as you know, gasoline has a lot of type of hydrocarbons like paraffins, like naphthalene, aromatics, and some other like sulfur, etc. So in our case, we are interested in the reduction of benzene concentration due to the adverse effects to the environment and human health. Why? Because benzene is a molecule with potential dangerous effect to the human health, for instance, right? So we want to use some solvents, in this case, ionic liquid solvents. Uh-huh. So this is the real situation. So our model consists basically, in the case of the gasoline model, in a mixture of benzene and dodecane, and a mixture of benzene and octane. Uh-huh. And in the case of the ionic liquid model, we have these several ionic liquids. Uh-huh. And we work with this system from two point of view, from the Gromov's force field point of view, and from the amoeba force field point of view, right? So this is the real situation, and this is the model, no? The abstraction of the real situation. So in the case of phase change materials, we have something similar. We have the real situation, and then we have to do the model, right? So in the case of phase change materials, usually they are used to data storage optically, as I told you before. So we want to take advantage between the conversion between glass and crystal phases because the electronic and optical properties change in these phases. And one of the most important known phase change material is the germanium antimony tellurium in the 225 concentrations. Uh-huh. What is the goal here? The goal is to find out materials with phase change behavior. And in our particular case, of course, we would like to connect the rigidity theory of glasses with phase change mechanism, right? In order to do a more systematic study about this kind of system. Uh-huh. So here just I put some systems that we have analyzed, like germanium tellurium, germanium antimony tellurium, germanium gallium tellurium, germanium, selenium, tellurium, no, and so on. So the model of this real situation is here. Here we are going to work with some mixture, no, that I put here. We are interested, of course, in the liquid state and in the amorphous state. Uh-huh. So we are going to do some analysis in these phases. Uh-huh. Because as I tell you before, the liquid state is very important in order to have the glassy state. Uh-huh. So the we can do this kind of analysis or modelation by means of ab initio molecular dynamic simulation. In particular, we are using Carparinello molecular dynamic simulation, right? So, okay. It's good. So here I'm going to talk something about, in general, about gasoline, that is oil used in vehicle engines, as you know, of course. So impurities or inefficient combustion can lead to contaminants, like carbon dioxide, nitrogen oxide, unborn hydrocarbons, etc., right? So aromatic unborn hydrocarbons like benzene are soft or pollution, of course, and also could be a source of a danger, to human health, for instance, Maybe a short exposure to benzene could be a source of air irritation, allergies, etc. But maybe a long exposure could lead to various types of cancer, Maybe. So here there is one reference about this topic. Okay, very good. I would like to move the Zoom windows to here, because I don't have the, I cannot see the whole presentation. So therefore, the reduction of aromatic hydrocarbon in gasoline can aid in decreasing the level of pollution due to unborn aromatic hydrocarbons, right? So pollution to the environment and also for human health. This is our main idea here. So what about gasoline in general? We have, for instance, this type of hydrocarbons. We have also this kind of hydrocarbons, very complex hydrocarbons in this percentage, more or less. Also, we have here aromatics like benzene, like toluene, et cetera. And we have also some other compounds like sulfur, for instance, Okay, so what about the ionic liquids? In general, we have work with ionic liquids and also with polar solvents. So in this case, I would like to talk about ionic liquids. So we have, in general, we know that ionic liquids are made in a sense because, for two types of molecules, right? One molecule with positive charge and the other one with negative charge. So in general, they have several properties, but I put some of them, like low vapor pressure, reusability. Maybe this is one of the main important qualities, thermal stability, and also chemical stability, right? Okay. So here I would like to talk a little bit about the experimental evidence of this situation. For instance, these guys some years ago have done some experiments about the reduction of benzene with this ionic liquid. So this was our source of inspiration in order to do something in this topic. So here we have, for instance, another evidence, benzene and xylene, extraction by means of this ionic liquid. Another evidence is the extraction of toluene, with this ionic liquid also. I would like to summarize the computational modeling in this topic. For instance, in our case, we have used a couple of force field for what we have used Gromov's force field and also amoeba force field. We have, in the case of the Gromov's, we have done the model of the gasoline, like by means of benzene plus dodecane, also benzene plus octane. And we have used these ionic liquids, right? In the case of the amoeba force field, we have to do the model of the gasoline by means of a mixture of benzene and dodecane, and we have used this a couple of ionic liquids. Well, okay. So here, just say, I would like to talk about a little bit about the molecular dynamics simulations from the classical point of view. Uh-huh. In general, we have the kinetic contribution due to the motion of the atoms or molecules. We have the potential contribution due to the bonds constraints or angular constraints, etc. Here we have some examples. No, actually, this term corresponds to the Gromov's force field. And in general, if we want to solve the equation of motion, we have to apply the Newton point of view or Lagrange or Hamilton, etc. In this case, we can use a lot of atoms or a lot of molecules. Uh-huh. We have several types of ensembles. Uh-huh. For instance, MBT, MPT, MBE, etc. And the contribution, the electronic contribution, are mainly in the elastic constants, no? Like here. And here are the electronic contributions, in a sense, right? Yeah, and here we have just schematic figures about the, for instance, this is the mixture, no? The decane plus benzene, and this is one of the ionic liquids here, for instance. Uh-huh. Okay, so here, this is the terms of the Gromov's force field. Specifically, we have several contributions, bonds, angular, Lennard-Jones contributions, the electric contribution here also, uh-huh. the dihedral contribution also here, etc. No? And here we have the terms about the amoeba force field. In general, we have something very similar up to here. Uh-huh. Up to here, we have something similar. But we have, in the case of amoeba force field, something else. This is the electric induced. Uh-huh. This is a very important term that doesn't have this force field, for instance. Uh-huh. Okay, so here we just want to present some molecules, no? Like a toy models, no? We have here the bonds distance, the bonds constrictions, the angular constrictions, the dihedral constrictions, etc. Here just is a schematic representation of the molecules with the Gromov's force field. And here, use a schematic representation of the molecules with amoeba force field. Uh-huh. So in general, for instance, for the Gromov's force field, we have our model of gasoline plus this ionic liquid, BM Pierce DCA, and the MIM PF6, EMIM PF6, in the case of the ionic liquid. We use, in this case, the Gromov's package. Uh-huh. We use the MPT ensemble. And we run over several nanoseconds, our simulations here. And something similar in the case of the amoeba force field. We have our model of gasoline plus our model of ionic liquids. In this case, we use a thinker package. Uh-huh. Also, we use the MPT ensemble. And we run, again, our simulation for several nanoseconds, right? So this is just a schematic representation of the problem. So here I have a movie, just a representative movie of the situation, of the problem. So here we have, for instance, the combination or the mixture of dodecanes plus benzene. Uh-huh. Here is the ionic liquid region. Uh-huh. So as we can see here, we have some benzene molecules here in the ionic liquid rich region. Sale? Yes. So we have here, we can see here that we notice a concentration of benzene molecules in the ionic liquid rich region. That is one of our goal, right? So here you say, I would like to tell you how we can analyze these kind of systems. For instance, in the case of the Gromov's force field, we have our mixture of benzene plus dodecane. Here is the ionic liquid. This is at the very beginning, right? This is the initial configuration. But after several nanoseconds of simulations, we have something like this. This is the density as function of the distance in this x, right? So we are able to code slides in order to have the density in each slide, in order to have these density profiles. So this region represents the hydrocarbon region, that could be something like this. And this represents the ionic liquid region that could be something like here. So in this case, after several nanoseconds, we have noticed that some benzene, some molecules of benzene are here in the ionic liquid rich region. That is something that we want, right? Here, for instance, we have something similar, the density profiles, but for the case of the other ionic liquids, in the case of imine PF6 and in the case of vimine PF6. But we can notice something a little bit different. Why? Because we don't have enough benzene in the ionic liquid rich region, right? Also here. But as you can see here, we have a more concentration of benzene in the ionic rich region. But here we don't have enough. Okay, so here we have the density profile in the case of the amoeba force field for the mixture of benzene, dodecane, demine, and BF4 unit liquid. So here we have something similar than in the previous case, because we have in this unit liquid rich region, we have a good concentration of benzene. But in the case of the MNBF4, we don't have enough molecules of benzene in the ionic liquid rich region. This was very important for us. Well, this is the most important result, but also this one, because we were able to see that these results were not bad at the moment. So we can analyze also these density profiles, also this system, by means of a quantitative systematic study, like the selectivity, with the selectivity, the S parameter, and the beta parameter. The S parameter is just a balance between the concentration in the solvent region and in the hydrocarbon region. For instance, this one represents the concentration of benzene. This represents the concentration of dodecane, but in the solvent region. Something similar for the beta parameter. We have this balance. This is the concentration of benzene in the solvent or ionic liquid region. And this is the concentration of benzene, but in the gasoline region or hydrocarbon region. So here I would like to show you a result, but about the dodecane plus benzene plus methylpyrrolidonium system. This is a polar solvent. Just I would like to show you this in order to show you that the beta parameter and the S parameter are in the order of the experimental evidence. Also, of course, this is a molecular dynamic simulation from the Gromov's force field, actually. But in the case of the BM-pure DCA, the ionic liquid with the Gromov's force field, we notice that the beta parameter is in the order of the beta parameter experimentally, but the S parameter is a little bit so far, no, from the experimental results, right? In the case of the ionic liquids with amoeba force field, we have the beta parameter and the S parameter, but unfortunately, up today, we don't have experimental evidence in order to see, our ionic liquid is, or our modulation with amoeba force field is okay. But we can take these results as a prediction in the sense that this dimine BF4 is a good candidate in order to extract benzene from gasoline. This is a prediction in this context. So here just I would like to talk about the interaction between benzene molecule with dodecane. Uh-huh. So here is the interaction between benzene and dodecane. So we have the benzene as this representative molecule, and we have this surface. Uh-huh. This surface represents the interaction with dodecane. So here, B and C figures, in a sense, is, we can have something like this figure, but in the case of the whole mixture, let's say benzene plus dodecane plus the ionic liquid also here. But these figures represent the difference between the figure, something like this, minus this figure. Remember, this figure just represent the interaction of benzene plus dodecane. So the difference is here, right? The difference between the whole system and this one is here and also here. So we have a very small surface here. It tells us that the interaction in the binary system here is very similar that when we have the whole mixture, uh-huh, in a sense. So here also is something similar in the sense that we have the benzene molecule, uh-huh, benzene molecule, but we focus on the nitrogen atoms in the D-MEM molecule. Uh-huh. So here is the interaction between the benzene and this molecule, especially nitrogen atoms. This figure, this surface represents this interaction. So here is, again, is the difference between the whole system, uh-huh, minus the interaction of the binary system, because we first put the benzene with this ionic liquid only, and then we, of course, we did the simulation with the whole system. Uh-huh. So this one represents the difference between the whole system minus that system. Uh-huh. So at the end, we have these surfaces that represents the interaction or the main interaction in the ternary system. Uh-huh. And something similar is here. We have the benzene in the interaction with the other molecule of the ionic liquid, in this case, the boron in the BF4 molecule. And again, we perform the interaction between the benzene with this ionic liquid only. And then by means of another simulation, we perform the simulation of the whole system. Uh-huh. And then we do the difference between the figure, something like this, the behavior, something like this in the whole system minus just the interaction between benzene and the ionic liquid. At the end, we have something like this. Something like this is tell us that the main interaction in the ternary system is in these directions, in the case of the benzene and the other molecule in the ionic liquid, in this case, the boron atom in the BF4 molecule. Mm-hmm. And something very similar happens in the case of the other ionic liquid. Again, we do the same analysis. We take the interaction between the benzene molecule and the nitrogens in the imim molecule. Use benzene and ionic liquid mixture. And again, we do another simulation with the whole system, including dodecane, and we perform the difference. Uh-huh. The difference between a surface something like this in the whole system and this behavior. And we have something like this. Uh-huh. Also the same idea of in the case of benzene with the boron atom in the BF4 molecule. Uh-huh. And we have, again, we perform the difference between the whole system and use the interaction between benzene and this molecule in the case of benzene plus the ionic liquid. And we have something like this. Uh-huh. So, we can see at least from a visual point of view that we have more interaction here, and here we have less interactions. Maybe, well, not maybe, this is the reason why we have this behavior, right? We have a poor behavior in the case of this ionic liquid in order to extract benzene from this hydrocarbon-rich region. Okay, so here I would like to mention to my colleagues in the past, José Alejandre in La Guam Iztapalapa, Edgar Núñez. After I came back from France, my first postdoc, I was as a postdoc with José Alejandre, just 1 year there. And we start to explore this kind of system. And then some years after that, I did a very small stay with Andrés Cisneros. And I did an analysis very similar with the amoeba force field, right? So I would like to acknowledge Andrés, of course, the whole team, but especially Andrés and Eric Vasquez, because their support. Well, so now I'm going to talk about a little bit about phase change materials. So, okay. So as I tell you before, we want to take advantage between the crystal and the glassy phases, because the electronic and optical properties are very different, right? So in a sense, imagine that we have a crystal system. Then if we are able to heat a certain region of this system in order to have a liquid state, then by means of a quenching, that is a very fast cooling, we have the amorphous phase of the glassy state. Then we can heat again this glassy or this amorphous phase in order to have a liquid again. And then by means of a very slow cooling rate, we can have a crystal again or something similar, no? So here, this is the process in the volume or entropy versus temperature. This is the classic point of view from the Colin, imagine that you have a liquid, then this liquid, if you call this liquid slowly, you can have this path and you can have a crystal with a melting temperature. But maybe if you call the same system a little bit faster, maybe you can have this path. And this path is the path of the glassy systems. So this TG represents the glass transition temperature. Glass transition temperature depends on the cooling or the heating rate. So the behavior of this quantity is very different to this, to the melting temperature, because the melting temperature, in a sense, doesn't depend on the cooling or the heating rate. With the TG parameter, the glass transition temperature depends on these quantities. And this is the reason why we are interested in the liquid and also in the amorphous phase of the potential phase change materials, because of this phenomena, right? So here, I would like to tell you that the germanium, antimony, tellurium in the 2-5 concentration is one of the most known phase change material nowadays. Well, in the past and well, in the recent years, I think. But what about other compositions? So we are interested in other mixtures. So in our case, some guys in the team are doing some experiments. Andrea, Vanessa, Annie, and they are in France and they are doing some experiments about that. And in my case, together with Matthew, we are doing some ab initio molecular dynamics simulation, especially with the Carparinello technique, in order to model some mixtures like germanium tellurium, germanium antimony tellurium, germanium gallium tellurium, germanium selenium tellurium, and some other systems. So here I would like to use a little bit about the molecular dynamic simulation from the ab initio point of view. In general, we have the kinetic contribution as due to the motion of the molecules of the atoms. Of course, we have the potential contribution due to the electron-electron interaction, electron nucleus, etc. Of course, if we pretend or if we want to solve the equation of motion, we have to do some, we have to use some technique, maybe Lagrange, Hamilton. Well, in this case, we can modelate a few number of atoms or molecules because of the cost of the computer simulations. Again, we have this type of ensembles, MPT, MBT, MBE, that represents constant pressure, constant temperature, constant energy, etc. So, but this time we have explicit electron contribution by pseudo potentials in general. So this is the basic Carparinello equations. This equation is the equation of motion for the ions, and this is the equation of motion for the Kohn-Sham orbitals. So for instance, this function corresponds to the Kohn-Sham orbitals. This represents the ion positions. This is the energy of the Kohn-Sham energy. This represents in general some constrictions in the system. And these parameters is the fictitious electron mass that is here. This fictitious electron mass is a parameter that we have to calibrate in our simulations, because this quantity change all the time in depending if we are modeling germanium, antimony, tellurium. This variable, well, this parameter has one value, but maybe if we are making a simulation about germanium, gallium, tellurium, this parameter is different. Okay. So we can obtain several properties from the trajectories once we have the simulations or some picoseconds. We can obtain some information about the structure, about the dynamic, about the electronic properties, optic, thermic, etc. In particular, we are interested in radial distribution functions, structure factors, coordinations, mean square displacement, diffusions, Van't Hoff functions, viscosities, vibrational density of states, electronic density of states, the electric function, etc. This is the main functions that we are interested in. Here, well, it's important for us always to do some comparisons between the experimental data with our simulations in order to see the accuracy of our simulation. This is a very important and crucial point in our context. So here I would like to mention in a more specific way, the systems that we have studied in the case of germanium, antimony, tellurium systems. Here we have several mixture with the corresponding densities and the temperatures. Here we have, again, the compositions for germanium, gallium, tellurium. And here we have, in the case of the binary system, germanium, tellurium for different compositions at different temperatures. So as I told you before, one of the most important stage in our context is the comparison between the simulation and experiments, right? So in this case, in the case of germanium, antimony, and tellurium, we compare the structure in the liquid state. So yes. So for instance, here we have in the red lines represent simulation, our simulations, and black lines represents the experiments, right? So in the case of the structure factor as function of the wave vector, the results are not so bad, I think. But if we visualize the radial distribution function as a function of the radial distance, we have something like this. As you know, the radial distribution function tells us the distribution of the neighbors. No? Here is the first neighbors, second neighbors, and so on. So one of the problems with ab initio molecular dynamics simulation is the first peak. Usually the first peak when we compare the simulation and the experiments, usually the first peaks the comparison is not so good at all. Mm-hmm. But well, in general, the comparison is okay, right? Good. So something similar in the case of germanium, gallium, tellurium, we have, again, the static structure factor as function of the wave vector. We perform a comparison over several compositions. Red lines represent, again, the simulations, and the black lines represent the experiment. And we can see a good concordance in the 10% and the pure tellurium. But maybe in the case of the 40% or 6%, we don't have a very good match. However, when we see the same, the behavior of this system in the radial distribution function, we see something like this. In the case of the 6 and 14%, you can see that the first peak, the match is not good. Uh-huh. Actually, in the case of the pure tellurium or the 10% of germanium here, germanium and antimony here, sorry, germanium and gallium here, the first peak also is not, well, the match between the experiment and simulation is not so good. Again, it's the same problem when we do this kind of, well, when you use this kind of techniques, we have something like this, no? In the first peak, usually. Actually, this is an open problem. Okay, so here, just I would like talking about the same quantities, but in the case of the germanium and tellurium, again, we have the structure factor. Again, we have the radial distribution function. In this case, the system are better compared with the experiments because it's a binary system. So the study is a little bit more easy, I think. So here, for instance, in these blue lines, you represent the partial contribution to the total. Uh-huh. This is the total radial contribution function in the case of germanium tellurium at this concentration, at this temperature. And these blue lines represent the partial contributions, right? I mean, germanium, germanium tellurium, tellurium tellurium concentration here. Mm-hmm. Atoms, sorry. So here just I would like to talk a little bit about some dynamic properties in the case of the germanium, antimony, tellurium in the liquid phase again. We can obtain, for instance, the diffusion as function of the inverse of the temperature, for instance. Here is the diffusion of germanium, antimony, and tellurium in the case of GST-225 system. Here we have, for instance, some experiments here in order to see that our simulations are okay, are in the order of magnitude. And we can obtain also the energy activation as function of the composition. In this case, these points represent the energy activation for each type of element in our GST systems as function of the composition, right? So for instance, these three points here corresponds to these lines. Uh-huh. The green line corresponds to this green, that is tellurium. This red line corresponds to antimony, and this black line corresponds to germanium. Uh-huh. Energy activation actually tells us, no, how difficult is that the atoms move in this particular system. So here we have the viscosity as function of the temperature. Here are our simulation, these blue circles here. This is our simulation. And we have as a reference other systems, well, other results from the experimental point of view and also from ab initio molecular simulation point of view. And the intention here is just to notice that our viscosities at different temperatures for this system are also okay. Mm-hmm. Well, in the case of the germanium, gallium, tellurium, also we have something similar. We can have the diffusion as function of the inverse of the temperature for the different atoms in the system, germanium, gallium, tellurium, uh-huh, at different compositions. Also, we can extract or build the self-intermediate scattering function like this. This function is important in the liquid state because it tells us the relaxation of the system, right? For instance, this curve, this line corresponds to a lower temperature in contrast to this line that corresponds to a high temperature for this for different compositions. Uh-huh. But in general, low temperatures are here and high temperatures are here. And we can study, we can analyze the relaxation of the system by means of this kind of function. Uh-huh. For instance, here, this horizontal line is just a parameter in order to take the times here, in order to build up something like this. Uh-huh. This is the relaxation time as function of the inverse of the temperature normalized by the glass transition temperature. And we can notice that when the temperature is lower, the relaxation time is higher. And when the temperature is higher, the relaxation time is smaller, uh-huh, in general. Okay. So also we are interested in the vibrational density of states. This is a picture from the germanium tellurium system. Why we are interested in this quantity? We are interested in this quantity in the liquid phase, but also in the amorphous phase, because we want to notice, to understand, to analyze the vibrations in the systems, right? Here is just a couple of representative figures about this system for this concentration and different temperatures. Uh-huh. Of course, when the temperature is lower, the vibrations are more concentrated at certain frequencies. But when the temperature is higher, of course, this distribution is wider. Uh-huh. Okay, so as I told you before, we are interested in the amorphous phase. Not only in the liquid state, we are interested in the amorphous phase because we are interested in looking for some motifs like tetrahedral or octahedral motifs in the amorphous phase. As I tell you here, tetrahedral motifs are present mostly in amorphous systems, and octahedral motifs are present mostly in crystalline systems. Uh-huh. So this is a representative of tetrahedral geometry, and this is a representative of octahedral geometry. Uh-huh. So this is the reason why we are interested in the tetrahedral fraction. So this is the tetrahedral fraction as function of the germanium concentration. Uh-huh. In the case of the GST system. Uh-huh. So here we have the fraction of the tetrahedral geometries. We have as a maximum here, and then we have a minimum around here, and then again increase. Uh-huh. In contrast, we are interested also in this quantity. This quantity tells us about the ability of the system in order to have a glassy state, because this quantity is the crystalline temperature and TG is the glass transition temperature. Uh-huh. And we are looking for compositions with a maximum like here. This maximum corresponds to this composition. Actually, this composition is the composition of the GST 225 system, remember? So we are interested in something like this because this kind of system are able to, when we find out a maximum in this quantity, this kind of system are able to have a glassy state. The glassy state is a little bit of, far away from the crystallization phase. Uh-huh. Okay, good. So this is the reason why we're interested in tetrahedron and octahedron, because of the amorphous crystalline systems. Uh-huh. And also this is the reason why we're interested in this quantity, because again, if we find out a maximum here, it means or tell us that the system is good in the sense of the ability, no, to stay in the glassy state. So here is a comparison in the case of the GST-225 system, no, in the amorphous phase, just a comparison between our simulations in the case of the structure factor as function of the wave vector, and in the case of the radial distribution function as function of the radial distance. Uh-huh. So black lines represent our simulation, red lines represent experiments, and blue lines represent some other experiments. Uh-huh. So for instance, in the case of the structure factor, we can see that by means of X-ray diffraction or neutron diffraction, we have a good comparison. But when we analyze the radial distribution function, we notice something weird in the case of X-ray diffraction, because our simulation has a peak here that the experiment doesn't have. Uh-huh. But when we perform this, the analysis with neutron diffraction, we can see that our simulation is okay with the experiment, with the experimental evidence. So here we have a weird peak, uh-huh, in the case of our simulation for X-ray diffraction. And this is nowadays is for us one of the understand why what happens in our simulation, something like this in X-ray, but not in neutron diffraction, is for us is one of the big open questions right now for us. So another way to analyze the amorphous phase also is by means of angle distributions. For instance, here we have the angle distribution in the case of a germanium antimony tellurium system. We have antimony angle distribution, we have the germanium angle distribution, we have all the compositions. Uh-huh. And for instance, we take this composition, the 10%, and we explore what about this the angle distribution. We perform the convolution, uh-huh, of this curve. We have this blue line, this blue curve, and this gray curve also. Uh-huh. And we can fit these distributions to a distribution like this. Uh-huh. And we can obtain the elastic constant. Uh-huh. And we can see, for instance, the black lines represent the elastic constant when we take into account the whole distribution, the whole angle distribution. And we can take the elastic constant when we take into account these red points, when we take into account just the blue distribution. The blue distribution correspond to the tetrahedral geometries or tetrahedral motifs. Uh-huh. So this curve is a composition of these tetrahedral geometries with some other geometries. Uh-huh. But for us, we are interested in some motifs, some representative motifs, in this case, the tetrahedral geometries, right? So here just we have the radial distribution function for germanium in the tetrahedral geometries that is represented for the red line. The black line represents the radial distribution function for the whole germanium in our mixture, uh-huh, in the 10% concentration. But the red line represents just the germanium in the tetrahedral geometry. And as you can see, we have the first peak very well defined. The first peak is very, very well defined for the tetrahedral geometries. So here we are, we analyze the case of the antimony in the same mixture, the germanium antimony tellurium systems. And here we are able to notice that the antimony can have some pyramidal or some defect of chiral geometries like this. Uh-huh. These numbers represent just the typical distance between antimony atoms, right? And maybe also we are interested also in the geometries on the antimony in order to see how it's related with the electronic or with the optical properties of these kind of systems. So some perspectives are here. For instance, one of them is the connection with rigidity theory. As I told you before, I would like to tell you, I would like to make the connection between the rigidity theory of glasses in order to develop a more systematic study for potential phase change materials. Also continue analyzing dominant motifs like tetrahedral or octahedral geometries on some others. Continue analyzing electronic properties like total EDOS and partial EDOS, no? The electronic density of states here. Maybe we are interested in the, not only in the total density, electronic density of states, but also we are interested in the partial electronic density of states of each atoms in the systems. And of course, continue analyzing other types of mixture based mainly in germanium and tellurium atoms. So here I would like to acknowledge some of my colleagues, Matthew, Mikulo, Andrea, Annie, Vanessa. I would like to mention UPMC University. And also I would like to thank when I did my, well, I did my postdoc a couple of years in France because of a scholarship of these agents. So I would like to thank these agents again. So thank you very much. This is the end of this presentation. I hope everything is okay. And I am open for questions or observations, comments, suggestions, whatever.
Well, Hugo, thank you for your nice talk. So now we have time for some questions. So if the people want to open the microphone and ask you directly, they can raise their hand. So now we have time for that. So any questions from the audience? Profesor Gabriel Merino, have one question, please.
Bueno, muchas gracias, Hugo. Estuvo muy interesante la charla.
Muy bien, gracias.
Yo tengo una pregunta. Imagínate que queremos desde inicio, desde scratch, generar un potencial para este tipo de sistemas. Bueno, sobre todo para tratar de ahorrarnos tiempo, pero el problema fundamental es que no sabemos realmente cómo se comportan muchas veces este tipo de átomos y bueno, eso puede causar problemas. ¿Tú tendrías alguna receta que nos podrías dar para generar esos potenciales y ahorrarnos un poco de tiempo?
En el caso de los phase change materials o de los...
Exacto, sí, o sea, de cualquier material en general, o sea, por ejemplo, simplemente cuáles serían como que los pasos a seguir para generar ese tipo o algún potencial que pudiésemos utilizar para poder modelar ese tipo de materiales, ¿no?
Ajá, sí, bueno, esa es una pregunta muy interesante y muy difícil de responder porque, como dice el dicho, ¿no? Dependiendo del sapo es la pedrada, entonces, tener un potencial que nos ayude a modelar materiales en general, pues sí está un poco complicado. De hecho, en este mundo de la simulación hay un montón de potenciales, ya sea clásicos o técnicas ab initio. Por ejemplo, Karparinello es una técnica, ¿no? Pero está otra como Born-Oppenheimer, también es otra técnica que toma otras consideraciones, ¿no? Pero yo decirte, hay una ruta para obtener potenciales de interacción, ya sea clásicos o de primeros principios, y ahorrarnos tiempo de cómputo, la respuesta es no tengo esa ruta, y un poco es prueba y error también. Por ejemplo, cuando yo empecé a simular estas cuestiones de los hidrocarburos, los líquidos iónicos, me di cuenta que hay todo un mundo de potenciales, dependiendo incluso la fase, ¿no? Hay potenciales que pueden ser muy buenos para la fase líquida, pero si te vas a la fase sólida, ya sea vítrea o cristalina, pues ya falla, ¿no? O incluso en las simulaciones de primeros principios, pues puedes tener pseudopotenciales que te ajustan muy bien bajo ciertas condiciones, pero bajo otras ya no tanto. Entonces, tener una ruta, un camino para, como dices tú, a lo mejor fitear algún potencial y ahorrarnos tiempo de cómputo, por ejemplo, en el caso de las simulaciones de primeros principios. Sí hay caminos, sí hay técnicas, pero en lo particular yo no las he usado. Porque pasa eso, ¿no? Que las usas para un sistema, pero ya cuando las quieres usar para otro ya no funcionan muy bien. Entonces, como que va cambiando en el tiempo la situación y no solo en el tiempo, sino también dependiendo qué sistema estés usando. Como vieron los sistemas que estamos analizando nosotros de telurio, galio, germanio, selenio, sulfuro, inclusive que no lo puse aquí, azufre también, que no los puse aquí, pero que también estamos estudiando. Son sistemas bastante complejos, que inclusive, ¿no?, en la fase líquida hay transiciones líquido-líquido y un montón de cosas de fenomenologías. Formación de anillos, formación de cadenas. Entonces, tu pregunta es muy buena, pero honestamente para mí es muy difícil de responder porque no podría decirte una ruta en particular para cortar tiempos, ¿no? Hay técnicas, que de hecho hoy se están desarrollando técnicas para cortar tiempos, ¿no? Por ejemplo, introducir redes neuronales, ¿no? El machine learning, ¿no? O el deep learning, ¿no? Para acelerar las dinámicas moleculares. Hoy día es algo que se está haciendo mucho. Bueno, desde hace algunos años a la fecha se está haciendo mucho. Yo tengo muchas ganas de incursionar en eso, pero bueno, espero poder hacerlo. Pero regresando a la pregunta original y a la respuesta, sí hay maneras, sí hay técnicas, pero de repente se vuelven muy particulares, ¿no? Muy particulares de cada sistema.
Gracias, Hugo.
Perdón. Sí. No sé si hay alguna otra pregunta o comentario.
Thanks, Gabriel. So, we are waiting for some questions. Yeah, I have a small comment. So, sometimes you have to deal with heavy elements. I don't know, where you have to include the relativistic effects and something like that in order to have a better model of the real system. So in that case, how is possible to introduce those relativistic effects in this big modeling that you are doing?
This is a very interesting question, a very difficult, because these kind of effects are taking into account in the pseudo potential in fields. As you know, the electronic contribution, the modulation of the electronic contribution are in the pseudo potentials. Uh-huh. So there we can introduce these kind of effects in order to have a little bit a better performance, no, in the case of this system or materials. But actually, this is another area of research. No? Pseudo potentials is a very specific area of research. In our case, we have to try from very different pseudo potentials. We take into account some that are okay for us. But if we are interested in introduce these effects, we need to analyze the pseudo potentials, and we need to generate or analyze in a more specific way, these pseudo potentials in order to introduce effects like this.
Great. Yeah. So it's possible. Yeah. By using the pseudo potential, you decrease a lot the computational effort to.
Exactly. Yes.
Yes. That's great. Exactly. Another question: so when you have to model this ionic liquid, I don't know if the level of theory is too relevant in order to model this. This very unique interaction between the positive molecule and the negative one.
Yes. And in this case, unit liquids are molecules difficult to to simulate because of this quality. And actually, this is one of the one open questions in the classical molecular dynamics simulation: how to model this kind of system because of this quality. Uh-huh. In our case, we have done the analysis, and we have found out that it's very difficult to simulate unit liquids. And this is another area of research to have a force field for unit liquids, for instance. Actually, I have some partners that are studying the development of force field for unit liquids, but it's not easy because of this quality of the systems. This is strong interactions at the electric level. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, that's why I was thinking about that. I'm not an expert of molecular dynamics, mm-hmm. but yeah, that interaction should be a little bit difficult to get properly. Yeah.
Yes, it's true.
So we have another question from the audience via YouTube. Is Peter, my postdoc, he want to ask, what kind of software did you use for get these pictures?
Well, in the case of hydrocarbons and unit liquids, we have used a Gromax package, and also we have used Thinker package. Also nowadays there are another version of Thinker for high performance computer. This is called high performance Thinker package. I don't remember right now the name of this package right now, but if you put in the Google Thinker or Amoeba force field, we can find information about Thinker. Also, if you in the Google put Gromax, also we can find a lot of information about Gromax package. And in the case of the ab initio molecular dynamics simulation, I have used a package called CPMD. It means Carparinello Molecular Dynamics. This package is is free, but you can or you need to ask for the code. Then when you have the code, you can use it as an open source license, but you need to ask first for the code. And in the case of Gromax and Thinker, it's a little bit different because you can download from some repositories or something like that, something like this. Yes.
Great. Perfect. So Thinker is also a free an open source software. Free or not? Thinker.
Yes, I think so. But I have used this one with Andres in some years ago. I think it's open source, but maybe yes, I think it's open source. I think.
Right. Perfect. So yeah. So it seems that we don't have more questions. So I want to thank you again for your contribution in this talk to our community. So our network called Red Latinoamericana Fisicoquímica Teórica is a good attempt in order to join forces or to meet different people around our region. So thank you, Hugo. I don't know if you have a website or a place where...
Yes, I have a website. Here is my email here. If someone can contact me, it's okay, it's good for me. And also I have a website, let me find out where I have this this thing. Maybe I can send you the link, no, to my
or actually in the Twitter.
Ah, okay.
The Twitter, yes. This the advice of your talk maybe you can add your website as a response to that.
Yes, good. That, yes, sure.
Yeah, that would be great. So, to the people who want to contribute to the second version of the Latinx Camp Twitter virtual meeting, we have the deadline for submission of abstract is for this Friday. So, if you don't know if you want to contribute or you can contribute, please go ahead, send us the abstract, and that will be great because the first version was excellent, excellent. There is some prizes, but at the end, the most important part of this activity is to join forces to discuss chemistry in our region in order to increase and improve our network of possible collaborations. So thank you again, Hugo. Thanks for the audience and see you next time.
See you. Bye. Thanks. Bye.
Bye-bye.